While the stories in this book are based on my experiences, names, locations, and identifying details have been changed. Conversations and dialogue in the book are based solely on my recollection and are not intended to represent verbatim transcripts.
Simon & Schuster Audio presents Just Pursuit, A Black Prosecutor's Fight for Fairness by Laura Coates. Read by the author.
To my children, Adrian and Sydney, if you were never more than you are today, to me, you were always enough. Introduction. The pursuit of justice creates injustice. Before I became a prosecutor, I never imagined that could be true. I thought that the job would be an uncomplicated act of patriotism and that justice was what happened when a person was fairly tried and convicted for their crime. For years, I stood inside a courtroom representing the people of the United States. I witnessed firsthand how our just pursuits caused collateral damage in ways I couldn't have imagined when I answered my calling to leave private practice as a civil litigator and join the Department of Justice. My time at Justice began as a trial attorney in its Civil Rights Division. As a child, I knew the stories of Ruby Bridges and the Freedom Riders better than the tales of Dr. Seuss. My mother grew up in a segregated North Carolina, only migrating north when her parents found work, her mother as a domestic worker, and her father, a butler and chauffeur, for some of the wealthiest white families in the Northeast. These families were the namesake of industry leaders, companies that I later happened to represent while working for large law firms. My father spent most of his childhood in foster care, and although he was raised in a relatively integrated Massachusetts, he was still a black boy in 1950s America. In spite of their humble beginnings, my parents propelled themselves to becoming among the first generation in their families to not only go to college, but also earn advanced degrees. My parents' paths crossed in Western Massachusetts when they were students at neighboring Smith and Amherst colleges, each only one of a relative handful of black students at their respective schools. They met just 2 years after Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated, when the fight for equality was far from over. They spoke often of the housing discrimination they had experienced while raising my two older sisters and me, and I watched the economic struggles faced by my father while trying to build a dental practice in a country where financing eluded black people. While laws were in place, the nation's conviction for equity never seemed to catch up. I was taught to understand the civil rights era not as finite, but as a movement that we were all duty-bound to keep in motion. Joining the Civil Rights Division in their work to enforce the Voting Rights Act was in service of that duty. The pride I felt working for the DOJ was immeasurable, but the bureaucracy was unbearable. Unsurprisingly, lobbyists and elected officials at the state and federal levels were particularly interested in our voting rights work and would often interfere, rendering an investigation futile. I needed a reprieve from the paperwork. I thought being in trial would help, but federal trials in the enforcement of voting rights were few and far between. One of my black colleagues told me about a program he had participated in early in his career that allowed DOJ attorneys with few trial opportunities to go on temporary detail to a U.S. attorney's office in Washington, D.C. He always spoke so glowingly about his experience, regaling me with hilarious stories of courtroom antics and theatrics. My request to participate was repeatedly denied, however, since the program wasn't readily available to voting rights lawyers, so I applied to work at the United States Attorney's Office directly. When I received my offer, I headed to my colleague's office for his congratulations. Instead, his normally jovial mood darkened when I told him that it was not a temporary 6-month detail, but a permanent position with a 4-year commitment. He closed the door, saying, "Two words, Coates. Human misery." He counted each word on his fingers. He said, "I don't know how to describe it, other than to say that you're not going to be able to get used to that type of human misery every day. There is nothing you can really do about it either. It just keeps coming." I was shocked. As a prosecutor, I assumed he would have been the only one in the courtroom who actually could have done something about the misery. Isn't that what was meant by justice? "Look, all I can tell you is be careful. You got to protect yourself. You're better off staying here at Main Justice," he said, distinguishing our work from that of United States attorneys across the country. "It's a lot to deal with." I felt apprehensive as I watched him close his eyes in remembrance. But I wasn't leaving the Department of Justice, I told myself, just working in a different capacity. I assumed it would be similar enough and that my work as a federal prosecutor in a criminal courtroom would be held in the same high regard as my work within the Civil Rights Division. I chalked up his admonishment to an assumption that he lacked what I clearly believed I had: fortitude. In fact, the transition from enforcing civil rights legislation to criminal prosecution represented a seismic shift in how others perceived me and even how I perceived myself. I had been a trusted champion of people who looked like me, but now I was often distrusted as an agent of a system that disproportionately filled prisons with people who looked like me. This created a struggle, an internal battle of allegiance, between the competing facets of my identity. It wasn't always clear which should win. For 7 years, I upheld my oath as a public servant, but my work put me at odds with my principles and lived experience as a Black woman. Over this time, I prosecuted in the name of justice while injustice unfolded on the national stage. I gave birth to my son the year Trayvon Martin was killed. I nursed my son while watching Trayvon's mother fight for justice for her own. As the country debated whether Trayvon had been racially profiled by a wannabe cop, I consoled myself with the fact that I was in a position to punish a real one who might profile another woman's child. Then, I had my daughter. 3 months later, Michael Brown was killed. I followed the case and saw the way the grand jury process was used to undermine the potential prosecution of the police officer who had shot Brown. As the country vilified the prosecutor's decision not to indict the officer, I told myself that I was different from that prosecutor. As a Black woman and mother, I believed that I would never exploit the power I had over a grand jury to somehow deny justice. I convinced myself that I needed to remain a prosecutor to balance the system. And then Tamir Rice was killed, and I heard the familiar script of officers attempting to justify their use of force. The same script used by officers testifying against defendants in my own cases. And I looked at my growing son, who always tracked at the highest percentiles of height, and was terrified that he may one day be the little boy mistaken for a man. And then I looked at my husband, a Black man who now feared his own death at the hands of police officers. He would ask me to explain why it was so hard to charge the officers in these cases. "There's no recourse? How can that be? Isn't there some way?" My answers could never alleviate his fear, only explain the process by which I had been trained. I again tried to distinguish myself, assuring him that prosecutors like me would make different decisions. But a part of him was resigned to the possibility that I might be the exception and not the rule. I was terrified that he was right, or worse, that I had fooled myself into thinking I could actually be the exception. We wondered how soon to have the talk and not the one white people have with their kids. We needed to teach our children how to interact with police officers and refuse to let either of them play with toys that even slightly resembled a weapon. I knew it wasn't fair to limit my children this way, but I didn't know how not to be afraid. And then came the day my husband stopped asking me questions about prosecutors' charging decisions and instead installed a camera in our car. I laughed, thinking that he had purchased another unnecessary gadget for himself. His expression dissolved my smile. He told me that the camera was for me. If he were ever killed by a police officer in a traffic.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.